Hello everybody, and welcome to a day in the life of the Hudson and Harbor. This is one of our favorite days of the year, where up and down the Hudson River Estuary, from the waters around New York City and New Jersey, all the way up the Hudson River Estuary to Albany, Troy, and beyond, we have thousands of students coming down to dozens of waterfront sites to study the Hudson River on one day and collect information about what lives in the river, who's using the river, the different communities here, the water quality, the parameters of tides and weather, and basically creating this beautiful mosaic of the Hudson and Harbor on one day each fall. My name's Chris Bowser. My colleague Jesenia and I will be showing you a site here on the Harlem River in the lower part of the estuary around New York City. Other sites in this video will move our way up the river, so you'll get a chance to see the Hudson River Estuary at three different sites. A saltier harbor site, a brackish water site, and a truly freshwater site, even though it will still be tidal with the Hudson River Estuary. So, watch and enjoy a day in the life of the Hudson and Harbor. Our site today is Sherman Creek Park, sometimes called Swindler Cove. This is on the northern part of Manhattan on the Harlem River, which connects the Hudson River to the East River. This is a beautiful park, and I want to note a couple things here. You can see this pier behind me where people can come out. You can see this beautiful gardens and forest here. You can also see they're working on doing some shoreline restoration here. So one of the things that we love to do in day in the life is fishing, especially with a big seine net. At this site, we're a little challenged by the muddy waters, but we're still gonna do a short seine right here and see what we catch. And, look at that! Look at that short little seine we did.
Oh my goodness.
Oh my gosh, look at that concentration of fish in here. Beautiful! This is called the Clearwater's Key to Common Hudson River Fish. This is a great dichotomous key that you can use to figure out the different types of fish you catch. There's also a free online version, so you can actually go online right now and check out some fish. You may have to come in a little bit closer to see what those look like. This is what's called a mummichog. It is a type of killifish that we often find in brackish waters, particularly brackish waters with lots of good quiet habitats like we have here at Sherman Creek Park. This is a beautiful fish. The word mummichog is an Algonquin indigenous term that means going in crowds or going in schools if you're a fish. And it really speaks to the fact that when you catch one mummichog, you often catch many of them. One of the most important parameters we measure is dissolved oxygen. That's because aquatic life like fish and crabs, they need oxygen to survive in the same way that we need oxygen here on land. So one of the things we're gonna be doing is we're gonna be taking a water sample, we're gonna be adding several chemicals to it, and then we're gonna be adding one last chemical that will result in a color change. Now, we measure oxygen in the water in parts per million. 0 parts per million is not good for aquatic life. Most fish really need 5 parts per million to truly thrive. So here, we're gonna add this reagent one drop at a time to a special volume of water. One at a time, hold that dropper up and down. That's one drop, still not clear. 5, now stop right there. That was 5 drops. That indicates we have at least 5 parts per million. So, what does that tell us about our oxygen sample?
It's good.
It's pretty good, we got at least 5. Let's keep going until it goes clear. 6. I can still see a little yellow. Add another one. 7. What do you think?
I think it's pretty clear.
That looks pretty clear. Let's add one more drop and see if we notice a difference or not. Did adding an eighth drop change it?
A little, but not that much.
So somewhere between seven and eight. So we're looking at 7 to 8 parts per million, which is good.
So the next thing we're gonna measure is salinity. And salinity is the amount of salt in the water. Now we measure this using parts per thousand. So now let's fill it up and see what we get. And what do you think it is? I think it's about 14. 14 parts per thousand.
One of the things that we measure is the water's turbidity. That's the amount of suspended solids that are in the water, or the cloudiness. Sometimes water is very, very clear or not very turbid, but sometimes water has a lot of suspended sediments. It's very murky, it's very turbid.
We are going to pour the bucket of water into the tube. And if you notice, something special about the tube is that it has a black and white disc. Now, why this is so important is because this is gonna measure how, basically a visual representation of when you should stop pouring out the water, and that will give you your measurement of turbidity, which is in centimeters.
Oh, wait, can you see the black and white disc now?
I cannot see the black and white disc, so you wanna make sure you look continuously into the tube until you see the black and white disc, and then you have to yell stop so he knows when to stop and you can take your measurement.
All right, I'm opening it up.
Mm-hmm.
It's draining.
And stop.
Stop.
Yeah, and I can barely see the white and the black circle, but you wanna make sure you stop when you faintly see it so you get the most accurate reading.
So let's see, what have we got? Take a look, everybody. What have we got for reading here? Jesenia, it looks to me like about 31 centimeters.
Yeah, I'd agree with that. So the next thing we're gonna measure is temperature. And you can take the same bucket you used for turbidity, and you wanna stick your thermometer inside the water for about 2 minutes.
Temperature's a good thing to measure for a lot of reasons. It really affects what fish you're gonna find seasonally. And also there's a strong relationship between temperature and dissolved oxygen. Generally, the colder the water, the higher the dissolved oxygen, and vice versa. So measuring temperature is a good parameter to check out.
Now I'm gonna hold it up and you can pause and try to read the thermometer yourself. So my measurement I got was about 71 degrees Fahrenheit and about 22 degrees Celsius.
Thanks everybody for checking out the Harlem River with us on a day in the life of the Hudson and Harbor.
Bye.
So welcome to Day in the Life of the Hudson and Harbor 2021. We are sampling here at Piermont Pier, which is River Mile 25. That's 25 miles up from the tip of the Battery. You can hear the waves in action. It's a very active river right now. Piermont is at the end of a pier. It stretches about a mile out into the Hudson. And we normally sample on the north side in this little protected cove that has a little marsh at one end and then this lovely shallow embayment. We're getting really fun data, so let's see what we got. Okay, we just finished 3 seines right here at Piermont Pier on the north side of the pier, and we pulled up a variety of different fish, and we wanted to share this one with you. This is a beautiful fish. This is a fish that we often find in the brackish waters. This is a white perch.
All right, another species that we caught today is a completely different fish, so come on here and we will take a look. So this fish is much smaller than the other fish that we looked at. So I'm gonna push it up against the glass. Can you identify what fish this is? This is an Atlantic silverside. So they get their name because they love salt. So that's how they get their Atlantic name, like the Atlantic Ocean. They also have a silver strip that goes horizontally down its body. And that's actually for camouflage to blend in with the reflectivity of the surface of the water.
This is a little friend of the Hudson. We find all throughout the Hudson.
It's a fish that we classify as anadromous, which means that it spends most of its life in the ocean and comes into the Hudson to spawn and goes back out. But conditions are so friendly in the Hudson right now that we find that it has taken up residence in a lot of the areas. These fish can get quite large. This is a first-year striped bass, but they get to be considerably larger than this, and certainly out in the ocean open, they can get to be really large, up to 5 feet.
But fish aren't the only things that we get in the Hudson. One species that we get all throughout the Hudson River Estuary is this blue crab. So one really fun thing about this blue crab is that if you look at its back legs, instead of it looking like little claws, they actually have these little paddles called swimmerettes. It helps them to swim very efficiently in the water, which tells you that this is a aquatic marine going species.
So one of the things that makes the Hudson an estuary is its connection to the Atlantic Ocean. And that ocean brings in the salt on the tides. So we're gonna take a look at how much salt is in our place in the river here in Piermont. So we're gonna use this very cool tool called a hydrometer. Hydrometers work on density, so this little arm is floating on the salty edge of the water, and we're gonna look at what the number is on the outside, because that's telling us parts per thousand. What do you see? I think that says 5 parts per thousand. And ocean water would be all the way up here at 35 parts per thousand. So we have just a hint of the Atlantic here at Piermont.
Now we're going to measure dissolved oxygen. So we already collected our water sample from the Hudson and we added some reagents to it. So now we are ready for our color titration. So here is one drop and we're gonna swirl. Two, three, four. Can you see it getting lighter? Five, six, seven. All right, it's looking pretty clear. Let's see, eight. What do you guys think? Is that pretty clear? It looks pretty clear to me. So I would say today we have 8 parts per million dissolved oxygen. The healthy range of dissolved oxygen is anywhere from 5 to 11, so we are right in that healthy range. All right, now we're going to measure turbidity, or the cloudiness of the water, by using this long sight tube. So we just poured some Hudson water into this tube, and if you come out over here, you're gonna see that throughout this entire water column, you cannot see the black and white checkered Secchi disc at the very bottom. So you can't see the Secchi disc at all. I'm going to slowly release the water until you just can see that Secchi disc. I'm gonna stop at that moment and then we'll get a reading in centimeters, and that is our turbidity. All right, so come on over. You guys are my eyes. Now we're going to get a measurement on this tape measure of the water column of where the Secchi just became visible. So if you look at the very bottom, it starts at 0 and it's in centimeters. So this is 10 centimeters, 15 centimeters, this is 16, 17, 17.2, 4, 6, 8. So it's 17.8 centimeters. And that's our turbidity. That's actually very highly turbid water, because it took us to release all of this water to be able to see the Secchi.
Next, we're going to capture some water temperature for you. We have a thermometer that's been sitting in a bucket of fresh water. We're going to pull it out and we're going to zoom right in and see if you can see what that thermometer is telling us. And if you got 23 degrees C, we would agree with you.
We're here at the Nori Point Environmental Center in Statsburg, New York, at River Mile 85. So we're going to start today by getting a shot of where we are, so you can see how it compares to the other sites and the other videos. And we've had two school groups that are collecting data here today at two different times. We're going to talk about some of the animals that were caught. Let's just bring them over here. First up, we have this animal here. If you want to pause the video and use your dichotomous fish key to identify this fish, pause now. That's right. This is an American eel, which is a migratory species found all throughout the Hudson River Estuary. Pause here to use your fish key to identify this fish. And it is a spot-tail shiner, which is a freshwater fish. So we've already fixed this sample. So we're just at the last step of this dissolved oxygen test. And every drop that we add here is going to be one parts per million of dissolved oxygen. We're looking for this to go from yellow to clear. So we'll count together. One. Eight. Let's put that against the white. Is that clear? I think we need one more drop.
One more.
Nine.
Oh yeah.
There, that looks pretty clear. So that's nine parts per million dissolved oxygen in this sample.
Great.
And our next test is salinity. So we're gonna read on our hydrometer what the salinity is at this site. And the salinity is all the way down at the bottom, zero parts per thousand salinity. Turbidity with our turbidity tube. So let's get our bucket, read our turbidity tube. Ready.
All right.
Stop. Okay. Now we're going to take our reading in centimeters. So what is the turbidity reading in centimeters? Okay, what are we at?
This looks like our reading is at 70 centimeters. This is the water temperature.
So we are at 19 degrees Celsius.
Hey there, I'm at the head of the estuary, the Federal Dam in Troy. We are 153 miles away from the Atlantic Ocean. I hope you have enjoyed Day in the Life. Thank you for coming and exploring with us today.